matter to me whether you think I'm a great preacher or not. That's not what I'm here for. I'm here to bring a message. And if I brought the message, I've done my job.
Amen.
Okay? And my message this morning is that God just needs one person. Not a crowd, just one person. I'm going to ask you the question, are you that one person that God is looking for in this generation? Because throughout the Bible history, it just took one person, one significant person to change that generation, and it wasn't always who you would expect. Sometimes God just needs one man, one person, one woman to make a change in the family, in the community, and even in the world. Because everybody is here on earth, you are here on earth for a purpose. God doesn't make people without any significance. And therefore, you have significance. Your life has significance. God has put something within you that this generation needs. Am I talking okay now?
Yes. Amen.
And so I'd like to talk to you about seven great examples. And example number one is the guy who said, I've never done this before. Well, you know, if you're praying, if you're seeking God, if you're asking God, lead me, develop me, grow me, God's going to ask you to be someone you've never been before and do something. Here comes my Bronx from back some years. You ain't never done before. And don't give me this stuff about, oh, I can't do that because I haven't done that any before, because that's exactly what you've been praying for. And I use this guy for an example. His name is what? Help me now. His name is what?
Noah.
I can't hear you.
Noah.
Okay, I have two hearing aids on here, and I expect you to help me with it, okay? God said to Noah, the time has come when there's going to be a change on the earth, and I need you to do something you've never done before. And dear saints, God has put within you, in your very DNA, potential, abilities, talents, creativity, imagination that you haven't even unpacked yet. It's there and you know it. Sometimes it leads you to frustration because there's something in you that says, I'm more than who I am and I can do more than I am doing. That's what God put within you, and he put it within you for a purpose. So you can just imagine Noah saying, Lord, I haven't been to shipbuilding school. I haven't been to theological seminary. I don't have the credentials. I don't have. You know, dear saints, if you're praying and you're believing, you got to cut that kind of talk out.
That's right.
I remember there was a guy in the Bible, his name was Paul. He ended up being Paul, and what did he say? He said, I can do all things. How? Through Christ who strengthens me. That makes all the difference in the world.
Amen.
And so what did he do? He was 600 years old when the flood came. And he changed the world. because he was willing to do something he never did before. I got seven examples, maybe. Example number two, you got to leave that past behind.
Yes.
Amen.
There are some things that you need to leave it behind. I know I asked the Lord once, I said, Lord, what do you think of your humble servant here? And the Lord, I think, told me three things. Number one, nothing to boast of. Number two, much to be ashamed of. That's me. How about you?
Amen.
Number three, so much to be thankful for.
Amen.
I said, yeah, that's exactly where I am. And so God expects us to leave some stuff behind. Your future is not dictated by your past. Don't let it. Your future is dictated by your faith.
Hallelujah.
And so the example is, don't look through the rear view mirror. Look through the windshield.
Yes.
Move on. Hallelujah. And so the Lord said to Abraham, get away from those people that are holding you back.
Yes.
In what I have designed for your life. You got to get away from those people who want to hold you there where you are. Saints, we got to identify those people and move away.
Yes.
And get out of there. And the Lord said, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and thy father's house unto a land I will show you. So here, he's saying, Lord, where are you sending me? You'll find out. What am I going to be doing? You'll find out. How am I going to get there? Just follow me step by step. That's called the life of faith, dear saints. That's called moving on in God and believing God. And so what he had to do was he had to do something he hadn't done before, and he had to leave the past behind. And how old was he at the time? I think I have the number up there. He was 75 years of age. Brother Roy, how old are you? 75.
Thank the Lord.
And when I went to Romania, and we're going to get to Romania, I was 60 years of age. I had left my pastorate of 20 years. And I went to a church board, and I said, is there a church that's looking for a 60-year-old pastor? They say, we don't have any churches like that. We want young guys, like Pastor Joe and Tammy. Man, life. I really didn't go to any church board. And then I went to a missionary society, and they said, anybody looking for a 60-year-old missionary? We don't send 60-year-old guys on the mission field. You don't know the language, you don't know the culture, you're too old to learn. I went anyway.
Amen.
Amen.
Is there anybody here that needs to leave something in the past? Leave something behind? Do I see any hands of people who've got to leave something in the past? I got two hands up. Okay, let's move on here. Number three, keep the vision. You know, many times we're supposed to be people of the Spirit of God. And when you're this people of the Spirit of God, God gives dreams. God gives visions. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And I am still seeing visions. So what does that mean? Yeah, I'm young again. Don't judge the book by the cover. And so keep the vision. And there's probably most of you who are here this morning. Oh, I have to tell you this, sometimes in Romania, I travel an hour and a half to speak to 12 to 15 people. And then I drive home again an hour and a half. And I said to God, God, is this an efficient use of my time and my resources? And this is what the Lord seemed to indicate in my heart. Roy, just go for one. Just one person. If one person in that place of ministry is encouraged, the vision is renewed. They have hope where they had nothing but failure. Go, Roy, go!
Praise the Lord.
So we have more than that here this morning. So I'm looking for just one person. I come here, I don't come here to make noise. I come here to bring hope and strength and faith to somebody who's down. I bring forgiveness and love to somebody who feels like they're out of the box in a negative way. Okay? So keep the vision, baby. And Joseph, have a dream. Be careful who you share your dream with, because not everybody will be in your corner. There are some people who will rain on your parade. They will be like a wet blanket. Who do you think you are? You think you're special? You're just like one of us. You were born in my city. You live with us. I know you. You will never be whatever your vision is. So Joseph had a family like that. And Joseph was a dreamer. But after all that he went through, and you know some of that he went through, he was a jailbird.
Yes.
Anybody here be in prison? Don't raise your hand. Well, I was, but I was a visiting clergyman. But here, when people had done him wrong, when people had stabbed him in the back, when people wanted to get rid of him, and the tables were turned, and now he's the man who has them and their life in his fist. What does he say? He says this. He says, "But as for you, ye thought evil against me." That was their motivation. Watch this. This is a wonderful three-letter word here. But. Can you say but?
But.
Okay, leave the last. There are no two T's at the end there. Just one T, okay? Say it again.
But.
Okay. Now the next three-letter word is this one here. Excuse me. This one here. But God. You say, but God.
But God.
That changes everything. That changes everything. But God.
Amen.
But God. And this is what, but God intended it. What is it? It's this. The evil that they intended, thought against me, God meant it, that, unto good.
Right.
And so, whatever has happened to you, you got the dirty end of the stick. People didn't treat you right. They gave you the left foot of fellowship. They rejected you. Love not returned. And so on. And yet you go through it. Well, that's what they did. But God. But God. And can change it for good. For what? Because God had something in mind to save many people, to save much people. And you don't know what God has in mind for you. And God uses what they did to push you forward into what He intended for your life. So here is, don't leave the vision behind. And how old, when he was a young man when this happened to him? Just 30 years of age. Anybody here 30 years of age? Besides my wife? Okay, here, number four. It's never too late.
Amen.
Now, I just got seven of these, so you see, we're moving right along here. It's never too late. God said, through the burning bush, that one there, God said, "Moses, go to Pharaoh." And here's Moses' response. "But who am I?" Low self-esteem. God can use somebody, he can't use me. You know, and some people say that, "I don't have enough education, I'm not in the right place. I don't have the right pedigree. I don't have the right this. I don't have the right history. I can't do what God has called me to do. So I said, who am I? We hear people all the time saying, who am I? And so on. And God can speak to you in a way that is unique to you. God does not speak to everybody in the same way. He's got a way that you will understand, and you will understand perfectly what God is trying to communicate to you. And God chose the burning bush. I haven't had another burning bush example since Moses. But I've had a lot of examples of God speaking. Okay? And how old was Moses? At some point, we got to stop using our age as excuses to lay down and stop pursuing, pressing on for God.
Amen.
Amen.
Moses was 80 years old. That sounds like 80 years old to me. Moses was 80 years old. I think I'm the oldest person here this morning. Is there anybody here who's older than me, perhaps? I don't see anybody. I don't see any old folks here.
Amen.
You think you're older than me?
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Am I allowed to ask how old you are?
It's okay.
82.
How old?
82.
82? Oh, you got me beat. Give her a hand, praise. Number five, be faithful. Be faithful where you are. You know, it's nice to see some of you. You're faithful with this church. You're faithful with this ministry. I got something to say to you. You know, this minister and this ministry has great potential. You got to look far and long to get this kind of ministry of music. You get the boring songs that can hardly sing, and all you hear is the people in the front, you know, and nobody in the congregation is singing because it's all coming from the front. And here, I got the impression that, you know, we're a cooking church, we're a bouncing church. Everybody's participating in the music. And I tell you, you've got some music director. I mean, when he gets a guitar in his hands, he takes this rock band stage. And I love it. I remember just last time I was here, 4 or 5 years ago, you know, that stands, I took a picture of the man so I wouldn't forget it again. And then little Tammy there with her hand raised up, you know. It's a beautiful thing. Be faithful where God has put you. And I used for that example Joshua. You know, he was number two man. I have a friend, he thought he was a tractor-trailer driver, you know. He was the 18-wheeler trucking down the road. But, you know, he was really a wheelbarrow. You know, be who God has made you to be. If you're a wheelbarrow, be the best wheelbarrow you can be. You know, sometimes God don't need a tractor-trailer. He don't need a pickup truck. He needs a wheelbarrow. And, you know, when we mix cement and gravel and sand and water and so on, and we want to bring it from the mixer to where we need it, we need a wheelbarrow. And be who God has made you to be. And sometimes Joshua, you know, he was the number two man. But God was preparing him for something in the future. And in that sense, God is preparing you for something in the future. And it's greater than you have planned out for yourself.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
And why was he lifted up? Because Moses put his hands on him. Moses blessed him. Some people, they went, but they weren't sent. You know, to have the blessing of your leadership upon you, upon your ministry, upon your behavior, upon your life, upon your support, it's a great thing to have. It's God's way to do things. And so, you know, Joshua, he had to meet a jackass. You ever meet a jackass in the room? You know? Yeah, but then God, he had to meet the angel in the room. And then he had to call down the walls of Jericho. Why? Because he was faithful. He was faithful. Okay. Number six, remember the Lord's promises. And for this I use Caleb. Caleb was 40 years old, and Moses said, when we go in to take the land, you got that mountain. And they worked for 45 years, and they remembered the promise of God, and he says, now I'm 85 years old, we've got the land, I want that mountain. Remember what God promised you. You remember when you were baptized in the Holy Spirit? You remember when you were first saved? You remember what God promised you? You remember what God put in your heart? Don't let it go. It may be 45 years ago. So what? Get the promise of God. What are we talking about? I'm talking about the promises of God, where the Bible says the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. You've got to go in there and you've got to take some stuff. It doesn't just happen. You've got to go there and you've got to claim it. You've got to get it.
Yes. Amen.
I never met a champion who said, oh, I'm a champion. How did that happen? It must be an accident. I'm a champion. Never happens that way. You gotta want it. You gotta want it. And I ask the question, what do you want? What are you praying for? What are you believing God for? You know, the Bible does not say, blessed are those who expect nothing, for they shall not be disappointed. We say that, but the kingdom of heaven, so is there anybody doing any violence here? Is there anybody who wants something deeply, passionately? You want this. God promised it to you. It's in your genes. It's in your DNA. You gotta have it. Well, how about a little press? How about a little violence? How about a little go get it? Looking across this congregation this morning, and God is looking, God is searching for not somebody who is mediocre. Anybody can be mediocre. If he can't do anything, wash cars and shine shoes. But if you want to be a champion for Jesus Christ, if you want to come out from among them and be separate, if you want God to work through your life and be not to fit in but to stand out, it'll cost you something. Salvation is free, forgiveness is free, but the call of God will cost you everything. It'll cost your dream. It'll cost your plans. It'll cost your own will. It'll cost, you got to lay it all on the altar and say, Lord, I surrender my life to you. I give my life to you. Take it and use it. And God will do exceeding abundantly above all that you could ask or think.
Amen.
Well, now that he got it, this is what he says. Pastor, would you read that for me, please, with a loud preacher's voice?
As yet I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, even so my strength is now for war, both to go out and to come in.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And so that mountain was filled with giants. And if you want to get to the mountain, you're going to have to meet a couple giants. Some will be outside of you. Some will be inside of you. You got to meet the giant. But he went out there and he got it. He took it. And he gave him his inheritance and so on. So what counts is not what people think you are. People are minimizers sometimes. You know, they see you as, but God sees you as,
amen.
Amen.
So when you look into the mirror of the Word of God, that's who you are.
Amen.
Not who you feel you are. Not who people say you are. Not what your past says you are. Well, God says you are. And my seventh point, you hope, is prayer is powerful. And I use Anna for an example. In fact, you know, she was waiting for the day. She was praying for the day. She was interceding for the day. She was a great age. Sometimes when we get older, our lives become more effective because we don't do what we used to do, what we do what we've never done before. And I heard that prayer is powerful.
Yes.
And intercessory prayer, that is what moves the heart and the hand of God. And so prayer is powerful. Don't stop praying. And so our journey, my journey, starts at 60 years of age, and now we segue into Romania. And so at 60 years of age, I sold my house in New York, and my sister and her magnificent prince of a husband, Alan, took me in. I was homeless. I sold my house. I was homeless. They took me in, and they're still taking me in. And sometimes when you're down, you need somebody to reach down and pick you up. And when that woman taken in adultery was writing in the ground, the King of Kings reached down to lift her up. And where I was down. But he reached down and helped me up again.
Amen.
Through other people.
Amen.
Through my sister and her husband, Alan. So they took me to a church. The first time I got in there, the pastor says, oh, you're Carol's brother. Oh, well, would you like to preach Sunday morning? I was going through such turmoil that I didn't want to preach. I didn't know if I'd ever preach again. But they were doing mission trips, and so I went with this team, and we built this church for gypsies. And you see, that's me there. You may not recognize me, but I wasn't less weighty than I was taller than. And so the job, now my degree is in physics and mathematics. I'm smart, in case you didn't notice. I'm also very humble. And I've been a senior pastor. And so when I got there, I was wondering, what job would they give me? And they gave me the job that was appropriate for me at the time. And they told me to take the nails out of old lumber. There's my hammer with nails. There's my nail bucket. Take the nails out so we can reuse the lumber. And I was glad to do it.
Amen.
And then in 2004, God put in my heart that, Roy, the next chapter in your life is Romania. Dear saints, sometimes we've got to close a chapter and move on to the next chapter of life. Just close the chapter. Don't go back and reread the chapter. Move on. Maybe there's more excitement in the next chapter.
Yes.
And so I had to close one chapter and open up another chapter. And the Lord indicated to me that I was to take my retirement as a pastor and invest it in this property. The property was $5,000 until I found out it was an American that wanted. And then the price was $6,000. But I saw the potential. Like God sees the potential in you.
Amen.
God sees such potential.
Yes.
And he sees that this generation needs what he has put inside of you. Don't die until you're dead. Don't die with all that giftedness and talent inside of you. Don't die until you've given this generation what God has gloriously put inside of you.
Amen.
And so here we go. And so what do? We do training. We're not better than these guys. We've just been around the block a few more times than they have. And they're effective, but maybe we can help them become more effective. And so we do some training, and how do we do that? We do it with doing conferences. We get these men and women together, and just let me show you a couple of these folks. They're not as meaningful to you, perhaps, but here is our local mayor. Here's a medical doctor. Here's a man who's over 60 churches in Romania. Here's an engineer. Here's another pastor. And a great musician. Not your caliber, but it's the best we got. We do conferences and so on. And we count on American pastors. I left the space between me and Pastor Terry there. That's me, that's me. I left a space there to put your pastor's face there. Okay. Why are we doing that? Help me read this together, please. For
God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Okay, follow me on this. So I'm doing evangelism. In order to see the doctor over here, you've got to see me first, and we do what we call spiritual assessment. So I'm doing spiritual assessment, really it's evangelism. And so I got a group of 8-9 people there, and I'm saying, for God so loves you that he gave his only begotten Son. What's his name? They all know it's Jesus. Jesus. And here, watch attentively. Whoever believes in him, do you believe in Jesus Christ? Yes, they all say. Do you believe that he's Son, God the Son? Yes. Do you believe that God the Son died on the cross for sins? Yes. Do you believe that he died on the cross for your sins? Yes, we believe that. Do you believe that he was dead and buried? Yes, he died on the cross for my sins. Do you believe that he's alive, rose again from the dead? Yes, I believe that. Then I said, then you are a believer in Jesus Christ. Watch this. Whoever believes in him, two things happen. Are you a believer? Yes. Okay, two things happen. Number one, you will not perish. Number two, you have everlasting life. I didn't say that, Jesus said that.
Amen.
Amen.
So the doctor, I showed you that. The doctor raises his hand. He says, well, you make it too easy. How about being good? I said, you want me to teach people to be good? Okay, doctor. I said, do you have any children? He said, yeah, I got a daughter. I said, when she was a baby, did she wash the car, do the dishes, vacuum the house, make the bed? He said, no, she's a baby. She doesn't do anything around the house. She's good for nothing. Why don't you get rid of her? No, she's my baby. I go, okay, well, she couldn't create any problems. Yeah, she stinks up the house. It's terrible. I mean, the drapes and the carpet, you know, you got to air out the house for 3 days to get it out. And then she cries all night. I said, you got somebody who's good for nothing and causes problems. Why don't you throw her out? He says, no, she's my baby. She's my daughter. I said, doctor, if you can do that as a man for somebody who's good for nothing and causes problems, cannot God do at least that for some of us who are good for nothing and cause problems?
Amen.
That's right.
The light went on. In fact, I would like to announce that God is looking for servants, and he's looking all over. He hasn't found any perfect ones yet.
That's right.
Except Pastor Joe and my wife. God doesn't have anybody who's perfect. He's just going to use ordinary sinners saved by grace, just like us.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
And he's glad to have us.
Yes.
Amen.
So that was free.
Yeah.
Should not perish, but have everlasting life. And so it's a team effort. You know, I want to be your missionary. I am your missionary. It's too big. It's too wonderful. I can't do it. I don't do what I used to do. Okay. Musicians are important. God gives people some gifts. This woman with a guitar in her hands makes a big difference.
Yes.
Just one person with a guitar in their hands. Yes. And so we do personal evangelism, worship, and leadership. And so God took me off the dunghill of depression and put me amongst princes. And that's my life's pastor of 23 years. Would you like to hear from my wife? Would you like to hear from Schnookums?
Okay.
You all have a postcard. You have a postcard. Put the postcard in your hand. May I have a postcard, please? Thank you. Okay, yes. I want you to tell people what is on the postcard.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Here is our home. Immediately it's in Germany. In Israel, Germany.
Where, dear? Top left, top right?
Immediately up. In corner, in the right, it's theologic seminary. Here is our home. Left people. In middle, the same pastor was over there. And now it's here. The same. Here it's corner left down, it's our flag. And here is our village friends, because Roy is very friendly. First it's our priest, Orthodox, and Roy, and police, and our mayor. Same was in picture. And in corner in the right down was conference in Karasebes, a small town near us, 30 minutes from us.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
It's a great pleasure to be with you in this morning. Thank you, God, for everyone. You are wonderful people. Thank you because you receive us again. Thank you for all your sacrifice, what you do, ministry for Apartheid in Romania or beyond. And thank you for everything, church. God bless you. Thank you.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
Dear saints, we're grateful for what God has done. But you know this, but let me please remind you that God is not a respecter of persons. God took me out of the dunghill of despair and depression and made something, brought me back to life again. The wheels begin to be oiled again. And what God did for me, He will do for you. He will do for you. I'm not different, I'm not better in any way. You know, in your calling, in God's way, I'm speaking to you, dear saints, who have lost hope, or maybe it's too late or something like that. Forget that. God is the God of the impossible. Or what seems impossible to us. So let's move on here. We do churches in all Romania. Yes, this is my wife's pastor, and that's your humble servant right there. And now God has opened up Europe. We are now in the Czech Republic. We're in those countries there. Serbia, Germany, Austria, Czech Republic, France, Poland. We have a modern day challenge, and that is the invasion, the Islamic invasion of Europe. And they're not interested in democracy, they're interested in Islam dominating the world. And they're coming into Europe with an agenda. And yes, their God, Allah, Akbar, is not the same as the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is an entity, he's a principality, he's a power, whatever he is, he's not the God whom we worship. And these are the countries that have been most effectively invaded by Islam, but these countries also to some extent. Romania has been less so, although they want to build the biggest mosque in Europe in our capital city of Bucharest. And they tell you, you know, just be quiet and you'll just be fine, but that's just not the case. They rule by violence and by death, and they even teach their children to be suicide bombers or something like that. That's a challenge we have, and we are in a purpose. We are in Europe for a divine purpose. We're not anti-Islam, we're pro-Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And the Bible says very clearly, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord will raise up a standard against them. And we're part of that flood that's raising up. Why can I say that? Because Islam doesn't know the presence of God. They don't know the witness of the Holy Spirit. They don't know what it is to be born again. They don't know the forgiveness of sin. They don't know salvation by grace. They don't know the knowledge of salvation. And I save this number six for last. They don't know worshipful singing. You never hear a group of radical Islamic terrorists getting together and singing praise. They don't have that. They don't know it. That's what we have. That's the standard that the Lord is raising up to meet the desires of the human heart. So God is looking for some champions. Is there a champion in the house?
Yes.
Is there anybody here who has heard the voice of God and are willing to follow Him wherever it goes? Oh, fill me with your blessed Holy Spirit, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Let the Lion of the tribe of Judah arise with the fire of the Holy Ghost.
Yes, Lord.
Baptize me afresh. Fill me anew,
yes,
Father,
Lord.
Because we've got a job to do.
Amen.
2005, we did our first conference with pastors and with some other folks. Schnookums was there. That's my wife. Schnookums was there. She was after me, and I didn't know it at that time. But a group of young people from America and Romanians. In 2008, we had 38 youth. 2012, we had 72 pastors and leaders in a building that was designed for 35.
Amen.
We've hosted over 100 kids for a week. We sleep 50. We just put the other 50 wherever we had carpet. There was a sleeping bed with the kids stuffed in it. Okay. So we have fresh vision to go back and be what God has called us to be. And so we're digging the footings for a new building. We're ordering sand and gravel and you know what, to build a concrete foundation, to build something like that. This is what we hope to accomplish this year, and build a building like that. We're downstairs. We'll be able to accommodate 125 to 150 pastors and have some apartments upstairs with some nicely appointed rooms. And so, dear saints, you may be few, but I've learned, you know, the biggest number of churches are not the biggest supporters. You know, they're spread out thin. But if we could be your missionary, you know, your gifts and support make a significant difference.
Yes.
$50 is 200 lei, and we can do a lot with that. And so Noah, he's gone. Abraham, he's gone. He's gone to his eternal reward. Moses, he was here. He did something great. He's gone. He was a champion. Joseph, he was here. He did something great. He's gone now. Joshua, he was here. The walls of Jericho came down. Caleb, he commanded that. He defeated the enemies in that mountain. Now he's gone. Anna, she prayed. She's gone. But today, number eight, it's your turn.
Amen.
You're on the stage of life. You can be mediocre. You can be average. But God didn't call you to fit in. He called you to stand out.
Yes.
Because it's easy to know. Can't offer you anything easy. But I can offer you something that's worth it. 1,000 times over, it's worth it. To God be the glory. Amen. Your humble servants.